on and to allow the alleged victim to testify. That's the motion we hear on today. State, if you wish to make an opening presentation, I want you to know, as well as Mr. Luca, I've listened to the proceeding that occurred at initial appearance court twice. First, when I received the motion, just to understand it better, and second, this morning, to refresh my recollection. So I'm fully advised as to what happened at the hearing. If you would like, I'll take judicial notice of that.
We would request that.
Okay, thank you. That will be done, and how would you like to proceed?
And the purpose of this motion is really to receive the information that the state had not received at the time, and that was input from the victim. She had planned to be there at 1 o'clock, and I know it was not you, Your Honor, but it was the case was moved up with little notice.
Yes.
So the point is really just to implement proper safety mechanisms and to just ensure the victim's safety in this case.
I understand.
So we would like to inquire about the address of the defendant, who he's going to be living with, the firearms. Are there any firearms? I know he cannot possess it, but does his roommate, does he possess any firearms? Just things of that nature.
Okay, fair enough. Would you like me to inquire of Mr. Stacy of that?
Okay.
Mr. Luca, I'm going to ask your client questions. He's under oath. If you object to any of those questions, feel free to object. I will not be offended, okay?
Can I just, I'm sorry, Your Honor, can I just make a quick opening statement to address some of those issues?
Sure.
Thank you, Your Honor. Your Honor, just to, and for the state's notice as well, I filed this morning with the clerk a change of address. Yesterday, I filed a motion or a response to the state's motion. Mr. Stacy is set to enter into a mental health inpatient treatment facility in Colorado, Edwards, Colorado, starting December 1st. However, between now and December 1st, he is asking for if he can be allowed to reside with his mother in Alabama. And I filed a notice of change of address. Or I cleared this with his probation officer. She has no objection. Actually, not probation officer. Bail officer has no objection to it.
Right.
So I did put that in the in my response, but I have no problem with the court inquiring as to my client's where he's going to be residing. But it will be in Alabama. It will not be in Tennessee. He does not own any possessing firearms, but I have no problem with the court inquiring about that.
Okay. So, State, have you received a copy of the notice of change of address indicating the address in Alabama?
We have not.
Here's a copy of it. It's been filed with the clerk, so you'll have access to it. So we have the answer to your first question. Okay, Mr. Stacy, I'm going to ask you some questions. You can stay seated. You're under oath, and I just need you to speak loud enough for me to hear you. Can you do that, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I have an address of where you're going to be residing in Alabama. Is that with your mother?
Yes, sir.
Who else resides there with your mother at this time?
I have my little brother.
And how old is your little brother?
He's 24.
Okay. And how old are you?
I'm 30.
To your knowledge, are there any weapons in that or firearms in that house?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. A condition of your release is that you not possess any weapons or firearms. You understand that?
Yes, Your Honor.
A violation of that condition can result in your incarceration and most likely not another bond set, although I can't promise that, but it would be a bad situation. You understand?
Yes, Your Honor.
Part and parcel of that is you cannot be in a house with a firearm. So if there are firearms in the house that you become aware of, or if you make a phone call to your mother right after this hearing, they need to be removed from that household because I don't want you residing in a house where there's a firearm. You understand?
Yes, Your Honor.
Can you follow that condition?
Yes, Your Honor.
Your attorney just informed me that you intend to enter a program in December in the state of Colorado. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Is that an inpatient program?
Yes, Your Honor.
How long is that program?
30 days.
Then you would be out presumably at the end of December, maybe January 1st even, depending on how long the 30 days is in their opinion. When you get released from that program, where do you intend to reside?
Just go home to back to Alabama.
Okay, back with your mother.
Place of residence myself.
Okay. So if I ordered that except for the time that you're in and participating in the inpatient program, you will reside at the Alabama address you just provided, you can comply with that.
Yes, Your Honor.
If you wish to move to another address, you're free to do so after your attorney files a motion and I approve that. I just want to know where you're living, okay?
Yes, Your Honor.
And you you understand that there's a condition you have absolutely no contact, either directly or even indirectly, through your mother, brother, family members, or friends with the victim in this case.
Yes, Your Honor.
And you can comply with that as well, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
State, is there anything else you'd like me to inquire? I think I answered all the concerns.
Please. Judge, if we could also inquire if he also has a residence in Orlando.
Okay. The location where this occurred was, I believe, an apartment. Is that apartment in your name?
No, sir.
Okay. Do you have any leases, or do you own any real property in, first, in the state of Florida?
Yes, Your Honor, I have a lease.
Okay, where is that lease?
It's at 55 West Apartments on Church Street.
And are you planning, or do you intend to return to that location?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. State?
Counsel for the victim would like to speak, Tommy Breyer, and present a statement as well.
Okay, I understand. Is there any other information you would like me to obtain from Mr. Stacy? For the state. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Fighter. If you'll stand and approach the lectern where there's a microphone and present whatever you wish.
Good morning, Your Honor. I'm Thomas Fighter, as victim counsel for Kristen Evans here. As I'm sure the court's aware, Article 1, Section 16 of the Florida Constitutional Amendment states that victims have the right to have their safety and welfare, as well as their families, considered in setting bail, including setting any pretrial release conditions that could affect the safety and welfare of the victim. Ms. Evans has not yet been given that right. We appreciate the court giving her that opportunity here this morning. So with that, I'd like to call Kristen Evans. May she stand here next to me or to give her statement?
More comfortable standing there next to you?
I think she would be best for it.
And if you'll come up to the lectern here for me, once you arrive, if you raise your right hand or vertical place your window up so I can get your identity.
You solemnly swear or affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you God?
Yes. Thank you.
Please put your hand out. Tell me your full name, please.
My name is Kristen Evans.
Okay, thank you. You may inquire, Mr. Fighter.
So, Ms. Evans, I understand you have a statement that you prepared and a few things you want to share with the court this morning. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. You may, of course, share your thoughts with the judge.
Thank you, Your Honor, for dealing with me today. My name is Kristen Evans, and I am a victim in this case. I have a 12-year-old and a 5-month-old that I am a primary caregiver for. You've seen the video, what he did to me. I was slapped, punched, literally picked up and thrown into my TV, and then picked me up and slammed me into my son's bouncy seat by my throat. This is not the first time that he's been violent with me. I am afraid for my safety and for my children's safety. He was released on the weekend, and I was too afraid to go home. I have not been back home yet. My injuries from this incident are serious and likely permanent from what I have been told. I'm just asking the court to increase his bond, place him on home confinement, and make sure and verify his residence and make sure there are no firearms in the home.
Okay. I believe from the report you were concerned, it might have been in the injunction request, that you might have had a fracture and you went to the hospital, as I understand it. Is that correct?
That is.
To your knowledge, was anything fractured?
No, sir.
Okay. You've been home since this incident, or you have not?
I have only been home to grab items with police escort.
Okay. Have you had, or let me rephrase that, has Mr. Stacy has any had any contact with you since he's been released?
Yes.
Okay. And you have a relationship with his mother?
Not any longer, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Anything else, Mr. Potter? Any other questions?
No further questions at this time. It's just some closing statements from the interview.
Okay. Remain here for 1 minute. Mr. Luca, do you have any questions?
Very briefly, Your Honor. The Justice Evans, I want to talk to you back. Isn't it true that you, between the time of the original incident that this occurred and today, there was an intervening car accident that you were involved in?
That is incorrect.
That's all the questions I have, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you. Did you find any follow-up questions?
No, Mr. State.
And State, do you have any questions?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Anything else, Mr. Fire?
Yes, just very briefly, Your Honor, if I may. Your Honor, it's our argument that the defendant is violent, that he is in danger. We've heard from Ms. Evans, and you've seen some of what he's done to her. You've heard that she's feared for her life and the life of her children. We consider him to be a very dangerous and violent man. After this happened, he fled the state. I'm asking the court to, well, you've already inquired of where he will be staying, who he's residing with. And we've talked about his local residence here that was not shared with the initial appearance judge. We're still unclear why he gave an address in Tennessee, but in the end, we're asking the court to increase the bond amount to order that he be placed on home confinement or some measure of protection so that if he is to leave the address that he just filed this morning, that our client is notified of that so that she can be aware he may be returning to the state of Florida. Obviously, it's our preference that he doesn't return to the state of Florida. Or ask that order there be no firearms in any home he resides with and continue to, as we have here today, respect the victim's rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fyler.
Sir.
Okay, the state, any argument? I believe it's your motion.
No argument. We did coordinate our response. I would have to note, though, I do have to let the court know that the address that was given to the IA judge in Tennessee, there is some correspondence that we'd like to see that when he gave that address to the court, he actually was not allowed to be at that address. There is another party there, and there is a custody order, and he was not allowed to be at that address. So that was just for your
information. There was a lot of paraphernalia that happened at that hearing that was unusual, to put it kindly. I really thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Luke,
very briefly, Your Honor. The rule that governs pretrial release for Rule of Criminal Procedure 3.131, specifically D, in order to change the bond conditions, the court must be made aware of new information that was not known at the time to the magistrate of the original initial appearance. For the record, last Thursday, just so we're clear as to how the events unfolded, immediately upon learning that there might be a warrant, before even the warrant was actually confirmed, Mr. Stacy retained our firm, retained myself, to try and inquire as to finding out the warrant. Apparently there was some issue with how the warrant was initially submitted to the court, specifically to the spelling of Mr. Stacy's first name, one letter off. He actually tried to turn himself in Nashville when he thought there was a warrant outstanding, but there was no warrant because it was under the wrong name. That was since corrected by Detective Dozier on November 17th of the Oakland Police Department. He confirmed that with me at 4 o'clock. I immediately got on the phone with Mr. Stacy. He immediately flew and came into Orlando. The plan was originally that I was going to pick him up at the airport and meet Detective Dozier at the jail to surrender him. However, apparently someone recognized him on the plane, and he was arrested and taken into custody by the Orlando Police Department. Either way, Your Honor, my client was not trying to be a fugitive of justice. He was not trying to flee the state. He was not trying to hide. He was trying to resolve this matter as quickly as possible. As far as the first appearance is concerned, that also was odd, because again, when I was informed of first appearance, that first appearance was going to be at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on November 18th, that was the night of, the night before, on November 17th. The morning of November 18th, I received a call from Judge Baines, the initial appearance judge's judicial assistant, indicating that they wanted to move the pretrial up to 10 o'clock in the morning specifically because that is when the alleged victim would be available to testify. And that's the only reason why I was moved up. So it was not moved up because of me or because of anything else. It was moved up, as far as I know, because of Judge Bain and his understanding of conversations that he had with the state of Bain.
I never thought it was moved up because of you. That's not a problem.
Okay. Or Mr. Stacy. I just wanted to let the court be aware of how this was. You're right. So initially, there was not, and again, I was not even given, there was not paperwork after the initial appearance to even review or time to review it because of the quick turnaround that we had. I had court here before Judge Adams at 9 a.m. and had to run immediately over to the jail to deal with the situation. So you're right, Your Honor, certain things were said in court that were unknown to me. However, they were brought to light. The injunction information was presented to Judge Bain, so that was known to him at the time. He imposed a bond that is in excess of the standard bond schedule pursuant to Administrative Order 0798-4717 and the most recent one, 2003-3924, which sets the Orange County bond schedule. Plus, also additionally, he imposed the additional condition of surrendering Mr. Stacy's passport, which he did. He did provide that address because that was he only provided the address in which he was staying at his last known address, so that was the only address he had at the time. That's one of the reasons why we're filing a change of address today, because we realized that because of this pending custody order that we were not aware of at the time, but since we've become aware of, Mr. Stacy cannot live there, hence he is now going to be living with his mother in Alabama until he goes to his program in December, and then will return to Alabama until he can get his own residence. So it's, again, not a fault of Mr. Stacy that this custody order prevented him from residing at that residence because no one knew that was actually an issue at the time. So I understand that this is an unusual case, an unusual set of circumstances that have led up from surrender to now. However, none of those were the fault of Mr. Stacy, and I don't think any additional conditions of bond are necessary, including home detention or any sort of ankle monitor or anything along those lines. It is going to further protect Ms. Evans from contact with Mr. Stacy. Mr. Stacy will be living three states away, and until December 1st, in which then he will be at least 2,500 miles away. So I think there's adequate safety precautions in place, and to satisfy the state and Mr. Fletcher's client, that Mr. Stacy is not a danger to her, her family, anyone else, and he does not intend to return to the state of Florida until he has to for court.
Okay, two states away. Part of Alabama, Florida are contiguous. However, let me ask you, and you made the statement, and it was going to be one of my questions, so I'm glad you brought it up. If I entered an order modifying the bond to prohibit Mr. Stacy from returning to the state of Florida except for court appearances, that's something that he could comply with?
Absolutely, Your Honor. Okay. No problem with that at all.
Okay. Thank you.
Your Honor, I'd like to briefly respond, if I may.
Sure.
To what Mr. Luke was saying, I don't know where he's getting his information, and I'm not saying he's lying, but the information he just provided to the court was not true. Yes, sir. It was not accurate. Our client, Ms. Evans, had planned on attending the initial appearance in person. She communicated that to the court personnel. For whatever reason, it was moved up. She told them she was in the hospital, she was trying to be heard, and her voice was effectively silenced. So
it was, which is why we're having a hearing today.
So yes, sir.
All that has been remedied. New information I've heard that the initial appearance judge did not, it's her testimony.
Yes, sir.
So I agree that would provide information if I thought it was appropriate to modify the bond.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Stacy, the purpose of bond is to ensure the safety of the community, and the primary purpose is to ensure your presence. Again, I gave your attorney very short notice for this hearing because I thought it was very important, and I thought that the victim should have her voice heard. It should have been heard on November 19th. It wasn't. We heard it today. I'm not going to modify your bond amount. I think the amount is appropriate only based upon your appearance today. So I'm not going to increase the amount. I'm going to modify a condition of the bond that you not enter the state of Florida except when there's a scheduled court hearing, and that you not reside anywhere other than the Alabama address you provided, or you reside with your mother, except for the time that you were in and participating in the inpatient program in the state of Colorado. Again, that's subject to modification upon motion, not upon you wanting to do it on your own. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
And to be clear, you were to have no contact whatsoever, directly or indirectly, with, is it Ms. Evans?
Yes, sir.
With Ms. Evans in this case. State, as you're aware, the Ninth Circuit not only doesn't have an ankle monitor program, but specifically prohibits the ankle monitor program from being used, so I cannot authorize that today. Are there any other conditions you think are necessary for the safety of your victim?
Just reference weapons and firearms.
Okay, which has already been referenced, so I'm only modifying by adding, not subtracting any of the conditions. All the original terms and conditions of the bond set at initial appearance shall remain in full force and effect. That should assist you in that. Mr. Luca, anything, any other concerns?
Yes, just very briefly, Your Honor. My client just informed me he does have some property at the 55 West address. He was just asking if he'd be allowed to go to that address today, obviously, before he leaves back to go to Alabama, to get as much stuff as he can to pile in his car and to the go.
Okay. So you drove down here, Mr. Stacy?
Correct. Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. And is it your intent to leave today or tomorrow?
Today.
Today, okay. You may remain in Florida. You can go to your address at 55. Is it West Central? Is that what the address is?
55 West Church Street.
West Church Street, okay. To retrieve your items with the understanding you're going to have no contact with Ms. Evans, not go to the location where this event allegedly occurred, and you will, on December 1st, participate in that program in Colorado.
Yes,
any questions about what happened here today?
No, Your Honor.
Okay, anything else, Mr. Luca?